morning, Inver Hills Church. Those on the live stream, welcome to you. In the balcony, woo! Hallelujah. It's a special morning this morning, amen? Why is that? Because the Spirit of the Lord is here. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Galatians 5:1 says, "For freedom Christ has set us free." Stand firm in your freedom. Hallelujah. Freedom from what? Everything. Well, there's freedom from things and there's freedom to things as well. Amen? There's freedom to love the Lord with all your heart this morning. There's freedom to worship and to cry out to God with all your heart. What a freedom, huh? You're not a slave to sin. Amen? What a wonderful thing. Lord, we come before you as a people. We're not even sure what's going to happen this morning, but we are excited because you are going to come in ways we haven't experienced you yet, because you're so great and you're so awesome. Lord, there are levels of the love of God we are going to touch this morning. Oh, God, I can't wait for it. I'm so excited. God, bring us to a place we've never been. Lord, set us free in a place we've never been before. Lord, we want to see things we've never seen. Lord, we want to feel things we've never felt. Jesus, come in all your great majesty and your holiness. Reveal yourself. Lord, it is hunger is the gateway to God. We hunger and thirst for you this morning. Lord, and we don't want to just presume upon it. We want to cry out for it, Lord. We want to cry out for freedom. We want to cry out for encounters of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we want to make it clear. We are hungry for you this morning. We have come to meet with the living God in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, church. We just invite you to stand up with us. Put your hands together. Put your hands up. Cry out to God, whatever works for you. We just invite you to worship with us in unity this morning. In unity and in freedom. Sing this out. Let praise be a weapon.
Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and we claim your victory. Let it rise. Let praise arise. Let it rise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. We cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift you high. All creation cries. Praise you, oh, we praise you, oh.
Let faith be a song,
let faith be a song that overcomes the raging sea. Let faith be a song that calms the storm inside me. Let it rise, let faith arise. Let it rise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. You cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lifts him high. All creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh,
This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like.
Thank you.
Just open our hearts this morning that we can receive your goodness, that we can see you in everything that you do through that lens of goodness. In Jesus' name, amen.
There's no
There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. lift your voice. Let your amen fill this place.
Morning. If you could stand with me as we carry this energy into our declarations. Remember, your brain believes what you tell it. And so, He is for you. What an awesome line to come into our declarations. He is for you. If you could read with me, I am called to be the light of the world, not the light of the church. I have been given responsibility and supernatural power to bring about transformation. Therefore, I refuse to have a mindset that empowers the devil and disempowers the church. I remember and thank God for what He has done, knowing He is more than able to do it again. I put my trust in God, not in the prosperity and the power of governments.
Yeah. Jesus, thank you, God. While you're still standing, I just want to pray a blessing upon the giving today, upon the presence of God today. We just thank you, Lord, for what, Lord, you show up every day. We just have to show up expecting you. And God, I just thank you today that there is just an expectation of you, and God, you never disappoint. And so, Lord, just I pray you just continue to pour out your presence upon those here and those watching, wherever they're watching from. Fill their place with the presence of God. Saturate them with you. And, Lord, we just lift up, God, your work, Lord, here and abroad. And we just pray that as we give, we enter into partnership, stewardship with you. Lord, you multiply every gift, but you bless every giver. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Here's what's happening at Inver Hills Church. Prophetic training and Club Fearless are today at 5:30. These are great opportunities for all ages to grow their spiritual understanding and identity. Also, registration is now open for Inver Hills Church's summer camps, all happening in June. There's soccer camp for kindergartners through 12th grade. Archery camp for 4th through 12th graders, and theater camp for ages 10 to 17. For details and to register, go to ihchurch.com. Or for easy registration, just scan the QR code on the camp posters hanging up in the lobby. Join us Sunday, May 23rd for a missions-focused service. We are excited to have David Millsaps come and speak. David and his wife Kendra have been missionaries to Eurasia Northwest for nearly 25 years. They bring with them stories of the challenges and victories they've witnessed as they train, recruit, do pastoral care to fulfill the vision for that part of the world. Men, sign up now for a men's retreat happening June 25th and 26th. Stay lakeside and enjoy a quiet, reflective time with fishing, bonfires, barbecue, and more. There is a sign-up sheet hanging on the welcome board in the lobby.
Is John 13:35. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another.
That with the mic on. Wow. What a motivational speaker we have there, amen. It was so fun to be a part of the musical with the Ruthies of the world and just watch their energy channeled in a positive direction. Amen. And that is the drama camp that's coming up. Well, we are in the midst of a shift globally, nationally, locally, as a church body. And all last year was a part of what God was doing and revealing. And as we make this shift, I'm going to take a shift from the shift and go into the blessing. And so this week and then next week we have the Millsaps. And I just have to just give you a little caveat. He and I were in Bible college together. And 28 years ago, while he and his wife were in ministry at Continental Bible College in Brussels, Belgium, he started to get sick. And turned out he had brain tumors. And they removed two brain tumors from him. And we had just went through that as a church body. The former pastor's son and long-term staff member had also had brain tumors removed. And my point in all this is 28 years later, he's on the mission field for the glory of God. You know, I mean, nada es difícil para Dios, okay? Nothing's difficult for God. It removed two tangerines from his brain, and he's functioning better than ever. And it was so God to watch him do that. And for some of you, you've had similar healings. And we serve a wonderful God that has no limits. And that is your blessing. And that's what we want to talk about. You know, in the last year or two, we've just seen such unrest. And in my lifetime, it's just seemed to increase. And how it's easy for the masses to channel their discontent and focus it on others. And you need to do this for me, and this needs to change, and why doesn't this happen? But I think a lot of that comes from the fact that they don't have the blessing of God. They don't have the blessing of their Father. And so I'm going to go into this, and I'm going to pray first and go into the scripture, because I just feel like we need to lay the foundation by telling this story. So God, I pray that you would help everyone understand, Lord, how important having the blessing of the Father is. And Lord, I was teaching on the shift last week, God, there's that shift from really the nurturing of the mom to the blessing of the Father. And the raising of the child and the releasing of them into their destiny. But God, what we long to and what empowers us to go forward, what gives us the confidence and the hope, is that blessing from our Father. And if we didn't receive it on this earth from an earthly father, we receive it from you. And that empowers us to carry that blessing to others. So God, I pray you just take this biblical concept and reveal it through your scripture and your word and your spirit today in Jesus' name, amen. Turn to Genesis chapter 25. And we're just going to read through really the story of Aaron and Jacob. And help you kind of get a little, you know, feel for what the blessing is in a biblical sense. I'm starting in Genesis 25, verse 19, and it says, this is the account of the family of Isaac, the son of Abraham. Now, Abraham, we know, a great man of faith that God went to and said, you'll be the father of many nations, and then he had to wait 100 years to have Isaac. And he was a man of faith in that walk. But in during that process of just agony, waiting 100 years to experience the beginning of the prophetic word that God had in his life. Now, yes, many things happened to fulfill it, but you being the father of many nations and not having a kid for 100 years, I think if that was me, I would have given up that journey in year two. Okay, maybe five. But 100? Seriously. And so here's Isaac. And the son of Abraham, when Isaac was 40 years old, he married Rebekah and the daughter of Bethuah and blah, 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 and the sister of Laban and that people. And Isaac pleaded with the Lord on behalf of his wife because she was unable to have children. What is going on here? God, at one point with Abraham to encourage him, says, step out of your tent and look up in the sky. Can you count the number of stars? That's how many descendants you're going to have. And he didn't have a son yet. He finally has a son, and here's the son, waits 40 years to get married, gets married, and his wife is barren. You might ask, what's the deal with the promise of God here? Well, every promise of God is going to be met with opposition. But the kingdom of God, the Bible says, is for those who persevere and those endure to the end. Thank God Abraham didn't give up. on year 20, 40, 60, 80, 90, 98, 99, or 100, but he persevered in trusting God for the blessing that God had declared over him. And then here is his son. And we know the story. He finally gets a son, and what? At the age of 11 to 14, he says, hey, we're going to go to the mountain here. You carry the wood. Guess what? You're the sacrifice. And he was like, what? And God provided a ram. But then 40 years later, he's married. He knows this vision, this blessing of God, and his wife is barren. What is he doing? He's standing in the welfare line. He's picketing. He's upset. He's asking for government help. No, he's not. He's praying. And he's believing in the blessing, and he's crying out to God. And she is pregnant with twins. I'm going to stay off of that one. But the two children struggle with each other within the womb. They're fighting with each other in the womb. Now, I don't know anybody personally that had twins, and I don't know if, you know, that's a normal, common experience. Ding, 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 in this corner. And so they're going at it, and she's just like, God, what is up with this? From the very beginning, the two nations, and this is what God says, the sons in your womb will become two nations. From the very beginning, the two nations will rival. One nation will be stronger than the other. The oldest son will serve the younger son. And when the time came, now some of these details are important, so please try to keep them in mind as I move on. All right. And when the time came for the birth, Rebecca discovered that she did indeed have twins. The first one was a very red at birth and covered in thick hair, like a fur coat, and his name was Esau. And the other twin was born, and he had his hand grasped on Esau's heel, little heel grabber. So they named him Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when his twins were born. I am tired. I watched my four grandchildren this morning for about an hour. I had to repent to all mothers. I had to repent to Kathy. I go, I don't know how you've had all your grandkids living with you and you've been taking care of them. I can't imagine waiting for 60 years to have a kid and then you have twins. And they're fighting even before they come out. But that's the story. And that's what's going on here. Here's a little heel grabber. And so we move on. Esau sells his birthright. So in verse 27, it says, and the boys grew up. Esau became a skillful hunter, and he was an outdoorsman. But Jacob was quiet temperament and preferred to stay at home. And I have to address this because in my lifetime, there's been this huge transition of, I just kind of assumed masculinity for all men, to masculinity being an issue, to it becoming a sign that you're not a man if you're not masculine. And I'm like, those are lies of a culture. Those are not decisions of God, okay? Those are not messages from the king. And I say that because here in this very story of the birthplace of the Jewish nation are two brothers, one of which we would see as Mr. Macho. And the way I grew up, it's the Clint Eastwoods and the John Waynes and all of those, and that's what a real man is. But who did God choose to build the nation on? The less Mr. Macho. And if you look at their lifestyles in this case, all right, Esau was probably a little out of control. And Jacob wasn't. And so it's not in your mannerisms, all right? It's in you submitting who you are in your nature to God so that the blessing that he has upon you can flow through you. And then who you are then so far outweighs the characteristics that somebody might judge you for having. And, you know, it's we become what we focus on. Had Jacob focused on the one that his daddy didn't like as much, the one that didn't go out and hunt, the one that, if he focused on what he thought to some people were negative characteristics, we might not have a nation of Israel today. I hope you're following in me this, because it's like, it doesn't matter how confused you feel about who you are, God knows who you are and created you to be who you are and has a destiny for your life. And so if you can focus on God and his plan for you, he can take your focus off any confusion you might have. There's a lot of confusion in this story. So we'll go on. Isaac loved Esau because he enjoyed eating the wild game, and Esau brought home. But Rebekah loved Jacob. Only one day when Jacob was cooking some stew, Esau arrived home from the wilderness, exhausted and hungry. Esau said to Jacob, "I'm starving. Give me some of that red stew." This is how Esau got his other name, Edom, which means red. "Anyway, all right," Jacob replied, "but trade me your rights as the firstborn son." Now, I'm the third son. All right. And even though the story, my parents wanted a girl. They bought dresses. They painted my room yellow. They made little toys for girls. So I grew up with an attitude in the first place, right from the get-go. And my oldest son was my dad's pet, and the next son was my mom's pet. And so there was this, okay, I have to fend for myself, get out of the way world, all right? And that's just how I bit off the apple that I was given. And you look at this and you're like, okay, Jacob knows without a doubt Esau's got the favor of dad. And he wants it. There are two nations. From their very inception, it was what God planned. And here's Mr. Heel Grabber. Before he even came out, he wanted to be first. And here's the other part of the story. When mom asked God what was going on, she told him, and she said, actually, number two is going to be number one. And so you got this whole, you know, controversy. And I think as a child reading this, being number three, you know, it was like, well, how much of the heel do I have to grab to get past two of them? But, you know, there's this, I was always intrigued by this story. So one day when Isaac, we'll go back and finish this, but Jacob said, first swear that you'll give me your birthright. Now, who in their right mind would give up their birthright for a bowl of stew? Oh, I think somebody who was too arrogant to think they'd ever lose it. You know, seriously. I mean, he just was like, whatever, just give me this. I'll give you whatever you want. So Esau swore an oath, thereby selling his rights to the firstborn to his brother, to Jacob. Then Jacob saw Esau. He gave him some bread and some stew. Esau ate the meal and got up and left. He showed contempt for his rights as a firstborn. Man, sometimes we that grow up in the church become so guilty for showing contempt for the very things that Jesus died for that we've experienced in our life. But because they're a part of our life all the time, we're just like, oh, what? No big deal. That is a big deal. The freedom that you have, that you can experience, is cost somebody their life, their shed blood, their broken body. It's a big deal. And we shouldn't take it for granted. So anyway, he says, I am an old man now, Jacob said, or Isaac said. I don't know when I may die. Take the bow and the quiver full of arrows, and he's saying this to Esau, and go out into the open country to hunt some wild game for me. Prepare my favorite dish and bring it here so I can eat, and I will pronounce the blessing that belongs to you, the firstborn son, before I die. But Mama, Rebecca overheard that Isaac said to her son Esau, and Esau left to go hunting for the wild game, and she said to her son Jacob, hey, listen, I overheard the father say to Esau, bring me some wild game and prepare a delicious meal. Then I will bless you in the Lord's presence before I die. Now, my son, listen to me. Do exactly what I tell you. Go out into the flocks and bring some fine young goats. I'll use them to prepare your father's favorite dish. What a conniving. Anyway, then take the food to your father, and he can eat it and bless you before he dies. And look, Jacob replied to Rebekah, your brother Esau is a hairy man. And his skin is, and your skin is smooth. What is my father? What if he touches me? Well, he'll see what I'm trying to trick him, and then he'll curse me instead of blessing me. But the mother replied, let's do some more trickery here. Then let the curse fall on me, my son. Just do what I tell you. Go out and get some goat for me. So Jacob went out and got the goat, the young goat for his mother, and Rebekah took them and prepared a delicious meal. Just the way Isaac liked it. And then she took Esau's favorite clothes, which were there in the house, and gave them to her younger son, Jacob. She covered his arms that were smooth, even the part of his neck, with the skins of the young goats. And then she gave Jacob a delicious meal, including freshly baked bread. Now, and we could entitle this section The Love of a Mother. We could say also, we could call this section Rebecca the Criminal. There's many ways to look at this. There's many ways I have looked at this. Rebecca went to God when those children were in her womb and said, "What's up?" And God said, "This is the deal. There are two nations, but the younger one is going to be the ruler." Is she just being a part of the hand of God? Well, if you look at the outcome, you can say yes. So can somebody deceive, cheat, steal, and still help produce the will of God? What I think is cool is when God is the master of the chessboard, he can go through all of that. All right? And so some of you in your life, you're like, you know what happened in my life? This happened in my life. This happened in my life. I was given away. And there's so many things that you can use to discount what you did and where you're going to go. You're like, it doesn't matter. I'm disqualified. I'm disqualified here. I'm disqualified here. I'll tell you what, if I was in charge, Jacob would be disqualified. You know, I mean, I know people who have won the Super Bowl who had microphones in the other people's offensive coordinator's booth and they were stealing the plays. They should have been disqualified. I mean, I know other teams, okay, who paid their defensive players $20,000 apiece to maim the players on the other team. And they went on to win the Super Bowl. They should have been disqualified. But I'm not in charge, and they weren't. So follow this story. Why is a mother worth, why is she willing to do this? Is because she wanted Jacob, and frankly, her favored, but also God's favored, to make sure that he got the birthright and the blessing. It was highly valued. So here we go. Jacob gets all dressed up in Esau's clothes, so he smells like a hunter. Takes the skin of the goats and puts it on his neck and arms, so he feels like a hunter. You know, the prophetic word today was that we were going to taste and feel and smell and see the presence of God. Well, senses are important. And it's a part of how you, your conscious mind experiences something. So here's Isaac up in years, unable to see, and all of his senses said, "This is Esau." You know, again, in fairness, I'd be going, well, then did he really bless Esau or did he bless Jacob? But the person there, disguised as Esau, was Jacob. And so what happens? "Please come a little closer, kiss me, my son." So Jacob went over and kissed him, and Isaac caught the smell of his clothes, and he finally convinced that he was blessing his son. And he said, "Ah, the smell of my son is like the smell of the outdoors, which is the Lord has blessed. From the dew of heaven and the riches of the earth, may God always give the abundant harvest of grain and bountiful wine to you. May many nations become your servants, and may they bow down before you. May you be the master over your brothers, and may your brothers' sons bow down to you. All who curse you will be cursed, and all who bless you will be blessed." So soon as Isaac was finished blessing Jacob, and almost before Jacob had left his father, Esau returned from the hunt. Esau prepared a delicious meal and brought it to his father, and he said, "Sit down, my father, and eat a wild game that I have given to you for a blessing, or for you to bless me." And Isaac asked him, "Who are you?" He's like, "What? It's your son, your firstborn son, Esau." And Isaac began to tremble uncontrollably and said, "Then who just served me wild game? I've already eaten it. And I blessed him just before you came in. And yes, that blessing must stand." If I was Esau, it's like, I might just think maybe I will provide my own provision for the blessing to change hands. Because my bow is very close by. And there's somebody already with goat skin on, and by now it's a little dark. I could just mistake my brother for a goat because that's what he is right now. I mean, I can't even imagine the feelings that were going on in this situation. Are you following me? It's like, he did what?
Esau's got to be mortified. And even Isaac, and yet he says, you know what? That blessing has to stand. Wow. When Esau heard his father's words, he let out a loud and bitter cry. Oh, my father, what about me? Bless me too, he begged. Then Isaac said, your brother was here and he tricked me. He has taken away your blessing. And Esau exclaimed, no wonder his name is Jacob, for now he has cheated me twice. First he took my rights as the firstborn, and now he has stolen my blessing. Oh, haven't you saved even one blessing for me, Dad? And Isaac said to Esau, I have made Jacob your master, and have declared that all his brothers would be his servants. I have guaranteed him an abundance of grain and wine. That is left. What is left for me to give you, my son? What empty, hollow, hurtful words to hear from your dad. Now, he's just telling the truth, but it's like, whoa, ain't got nothing in this bag left for you, buddy. Woo! But do you have only one blessing? Oh, my father, bless me too. And Esau broke down and wept. And finally, the father Isaac said to him, you will live away from the riches of the earth and away from the dew of the heaven above. And you will live by the sword and you will serve your brother. But when you decide to break free, you will shake his yoke off of your neck. You know, I think there are prophetic words of God in both blessings for you today. Number one, and I'm going to explain this over the next 2 weeks of this message, I believe in my whole heart that Jesus came not only as the firstborn son, but the only son. And you see, in this culture of Israel, the firstborn son, the blessing and the birthright was his. And why that was so important is because unless you became a rabbi and you were of the tribe that was to be in the ministry, the firstborn son, they all learned the trade of the father, and the firstborn son was in charge. He got the family business. So if you were number two or number three like me or number five or seven, it doesn't matter. You were born to serve your older brother. I don't know about you, but I couldn't live with that very well. You know, and neither could they. And that's why in the culture, it was not uncommon for them, especially in Galilean tradition, for them to go to their father and say, give me my inheritance, and for them to be prodigal sons because they didn't want to serve their brother and be a part of that. They didn't feel it was fair. I didn't have a choice. So being a prodigal was common. Jacob did not want to be a prodigal. He didn't want to be a servant to his brother, and his mom helped him steal away those things. Even though God said it would happen, it still wasn't, you know what I mean? Where's ethics in this? Where's justice in this? And yet, when it's all done, where's Esau? It's like, Dad, all these years you and I had this thing going, and now you're saying you got nothing for me? And yet, what does he say at the end of Esau's blessing? Because see, there's hope in there for everyone. When you decide to break free, you will shake this yoke from your neck. That line just, it wasn't even a plan to be a part of the message. When I read that, I feel like whatever your situation, whatever your family order was, whatever's happened to you, no matter how fair or unfair it is, and you know, and being in the ministry all these years, when a parent dies is when the true condition of the family is revealed. And it's usually tragic. Because you're like, oh, they'll all get together and have a great time and love each other. Oh, no, no, no. I mean, I've experienced where's your sister right now? I don't know. Her husband and kids aren't here. Where are they? Well, they got a U-Haul, and while the funeral was going on, they went to the house and they took everything they want and they left town. You know, and all this, and all of a sudden it becomes about stuff, and you realize that maybe stuff was at the forefront of the family instead of the family in the first place. But whatever your situation is, if you are not favored in your family, you still have the blessing of God. And what it is this Esau blessing where God says to you, when you decide to break free, okay, maybe you have to break free from your family. When you decide to do that and you put your trust in God, what does he say will happen? You'll shake this yoke off and you will have the blessing of the Lord and you will prosper. So with God, my point here, and I need to move on, with God, my point here is it's a win-win. All right? And is it fair? Well, let's see. When God's pie is the universe, it really doesn't matter if you get the biggest piece, the first piece, the small piece, or the last piece. All pieces are eternal. You're a winner. Jacob flees. You know, he runs away. Which is to be expected. You know, you're just like, you steal it and then you run away. Wait till I see you again. Esau hated Jacob because his father had given Jacob the blessing, and Esau began to scheme. Oh, I'll tell you when I see him. Yeah. I'll soon be mourning my father's death, yet I will kill my brother Jacob. But Rebekah heard Esau's plans, so he sent Jacob and told him, get out of here. Esau's counseled, consoling himself by plotting to kill you. Listen carefully, my son. Get ready and flee to my brother Laban and Haran. Stay there. Genesis 32, 22, during the night, Jacob got up and took his two wives. So this is much later. He had gone to Laban. It's a whole nother story. He wants to marry Rachel, and he gets Leah. And then he has to work 7 more years for Rachel. And he wants Rachel to bear him a kid. And this, again, there's so much controversy in the heritage and the lineage of Jesus. And yet, it all happened. And I find in the blessing of God, in the story of Israel, you can find solace and console in the fact that it doesn't matter how many trials you went through. If you pursue what God has for you, you can overcome. And if you persevere, the kingdom of heaven is yours. But it's time to go back. So during the night, Jacob got up, took his two wives and his two servant wives and the 11 sons, and he crossed the river. After taking them to the other side, he sent over to all of his possessions and let this left Jacob all alone in his camp, and a man came and wrestled with him until dawn. When the man saw that he would not win the match, he touched Jacob's hip and wrenched it out of socket. And when the man said, let me go, for the dawn is breaking, Jacob says, I'm not going to let you go unless you bless me. Now, what does that tell us about Jacob? He has learned the power and the importance of the blessing. I mean, he just has. How important it is to have the blessing upon you, the favor upon you, not only of God, but in this case, who he's wrestling with, which we know as either Jesus himself or an angel. And so he's like, I won't let you go until you bless me. What is your name? The man said. He said, Jacob. And he says, no, your name will no longer be Jacob. From now on, you will be called Israel, because you have fought with God and with man and have won. So he becomes the namesake of the nation of Israel by fighting for what he has. Now, I don't mean pick up a gun and go shoot people. I'm just saying God does his part, but you need to be willing to do yours. Now, he empowers you, he blesses you, he provides for you. But even in Esau's blessing, what did he say? When you choose to break free, when you choose. On Wednesday nights, we're going through The Chosen, and the name is very apropos. For many are called, but few choose. For those that choose to break free from the sins of this world, from the structure and the style of this world, for those who choose the will of God, they walk in the blessing of God. For those who choose to fight for the inheritance that God has given them, to take the land. Look at the nation of Israel themselves. They had to go in and fight for the land. It was promised, but they had to go fight for it. And you see this, what the power of the blessing is, how important it is, but you still have to respond to it. You still have to step into it. You still have to put it on. Please tell me your name. Why do you want to know my name? The man replied. Then he blessed Jacob there. Jacob named the place Peniel, which is the face of God. For he said, I have seen God face to face, yet my life has been spared. The sun was rising on Jacob when he left. In Genesis 33, Jacob looked up on his way back and he sees Esau coming with 400 men. You know what this would be called? In my book, I would write Judgment Day. And he divided the children among Leah and Rachel and his two servant wives. He put the servant wives and his children. I mean, he's strategizing, man. He's like, I want you, you guys go over here, you guys go over here. And then Joseph was last. And you know what tells me about this? And I know I'm out of time and I got to cruise in here, but Isaac had a favorite. Rebecca had a favorite. Joseph had a favorite of 12. It's like, is this fair? No, it's not fair. In fact, is the word fair in the Bible? I don't know. I know it is, though. Faith, destiny, adoption, heritage, the blessing of God. And then there's this guy by the name of Jesus. And we'll come back to this story in 2 weeks, but there's this guy by the name of Jesus. And when we get done with the story of Jacob and Esau and what comes out of that, which is Jesus, the nation of Israel, the promised land, the promised people of God. But then there's Jesus, the only begotten Son who carried a birthright and a blessing that only the Son of God could carry. And yet, he went to the cross and he willingly gave up everything. And I really believe with my whole heart, part of what he gave up and shared with every one of his brothers and sisters was his birthright and his blessing. In fact, these two messages on the blessing precede the next sermon series we'll go into, which is on the Holy Spirit. And I believe with all my whole heart that you know what your birthright is? If you decide to be a son and daughter of God, your birthright is the Holy Spirit. And you know what your blessing is? The baptism of the Holy Spirit. As he pours his Spirit out upon you and you walk in the power of the blessing of God. You see, the Holy Spirit was the promise that God gave to Abraham before he was even the leader of the nation of Israel. Now we see in this story of the history of Israel how important the birthright and the blessing are. And sometimes you can connive and cheat your way into it, but you know what? That's if you're number one or number two, but if you're the rest of us, you had no hope until Jesus came. And then he said, here. And he willingly laid down all that he carried so that it was there for you. There is so much hope in the blessing of God, but it's for every single one of you. It erases whatever hurts of the past, whatever injustice you've ever had, because Jesus made it available to all of you. I want you to stand with me this morning. I don't know. I mean, it's like, how in the world am I going to get through that story and get to the next story? And God just said, tell the story. So I'm just going to tell the story. But I hope in the story that the Holy Spirit connects your story with the story of the Word of God. And it gives you hope. It gives you life. It helps you to know that God has a way for you to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. He has a blessing and a birthright waiting for you, made possible for each and every one of you. And it's all equal, right? There's no greater than or less than, because Jesus, who was the firstborn, gave his life so that every single one of you could come into the family of God on an equal playing field. Adopted sons and daughters of the Most High God with the favor and the blessing of God on your life. And I just want to give you an opportunity now, whether you're in this building or whether you're watching live. Man, if you haven't accepted Jesus, what you haven't received is the blessing and the birthright of God, his favor on your life, the great equalizer. But what about the hurts and the rejection and abandonment of the past, Jesus took that to the cross for you. He took your pain. He took your sorrow. He took your abandonment to the cross for you and died for you so that you could experience the acceptance, the blessing, and the birthright that he has as the Son of God. And that's why the Bible says you're not just slaves, you're not just friends, you're joint heirs with Jesus. So if you want Jesus this morning, I just want you, wherever you are, just to raise your hand and put your other hand on your heart. And just repeat after me, dear Jesus, I thank you for the sacrifice you made. Lord, dying on the cross for me, paying the price for my sins, taking on my hurt, taking on my abandonment and my shame. And now I call upon your name, in the name of Jesus, and I ask you to come into my life. Share your blessing, share your birthright, share your identity, share your family with me. God, adopt me in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We're going to sing the blessing together. I'm going to have David come and just pray a blessing over you. But if you're struggling with identity, if this year has just left you a little lost, dazed and confused, join the club. I mean, it's been a tough one, but God's calling us back and opening the doors. But if you just need that touch of the Father, prayer team, if you'd come and just be ready. And when Dave prays a blessing over the church, we'll be here waiting for you to pray with you. The rest of you, when Dave gets done, you can worship with us, take some time, or find your way to the foyer. Don't get so wrapped up in God you forget you have children here and they need to be picked up. There's also Panera in the fellowship hall. If you haven't seen your friends in a while, please go in there and say hi. But there's ministry waiting for you here. There's food waiting for you out there. And there's kids waiting for you in the nursery and in children's ministry. David.
Thank you, Pastor Bart. Maybe some of you, when you heard this message, your mind maybe even went to a place where you feel like, man, I feel like in some areas of my life, I'm not blessed. There's been a particular area that's been almost, I would almost say cursed, the opposite. Now we know from Scripture that weapons can be formed against us, right? And so maybe there is. But the Scripture says that no weapon formed against us shall what? Prosper. Amen? And we all experience difficulties, whether it's in finances or health or relationships. And it feels so difficult and hard sometimes. But there's this wonderful invitation in Revelations when Jesus is speaking to the church. He says, if anyone, he goes, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone hears and opens the door, I will come in and I will fellowship with them. There is an amazing invitation this morning to come in to the fellowship and the blessing of the Lord. And it may be even a particular area of your life that was once seemingly cursed. The Lord says, I want to turn that into a blessing. So I am going to encourage you this morning, if there is something, even in your mind, while this sermon was going on, I want you to come forward. He turns what? Graves into gardens. We sang it earlier. Bones into armies. Seas into highways. The Lord is here to transform something in your life this morning. So Lord, I lift up my heart. I lift up this church, this congregation. And we declare that we are in the blessing and the family of God. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. For we have been added in to the lineage of God. We are part of the wonderful family. We are in the blessing of God. And so we look up to you, Lord, and we say, Father, I want all that you have. Lord, just as you said to the older prodigals, the prodigal son's older brother, you said, all that I have is yours. You're with me here. So Lord, we look to you and we see the awesomeness of the kingdom of God and all its blessing. And we say, yes, Lord. I hear the knock on the door. I hear your invitation. I respond with a yes and an amen this morning to your voice. I want to obey and I want to say yes to your calling on my life in every way, and I shall be blessed in Jesus' name. Amen.